Thank you very much, and good afternoon to everybody. I'm really glad of the invitation and the possibility to be here. I just will start a little bit my talk, considering the fact that I'm here not only representing my university, and therefore what I'm going to say with respect to the research they were doing here, they are actually, but basically also giving some talk about the Geoscience and Remosensing Society, which, as you know, is one of the sponsors of this conference. So the outline of my talk will be basically as we standard a scientific talk, but before, in reality, before we start the actual talk, I will introduce a little bit the IEEE Geoscience and Remote Sensing Society, or IEEE GRSS. I'm pretty sure most of you know it, but just to recall everybody, IEEE doesn't mean anymore. I mean, people are used to say that IEEE means Institute of Electronics and Electrical Engineers, but right now, if you ask the IEEE president what does it mean, he or she replies, IEEE. That's it. There is no more the stress on the being an engineer, and this is typically what we want to stress here in the remote sensing arena, where most of the people here are not engineers or do not come from an engineering, background. In any case, IEEE is the largest academic and professional society in the world. This is by no discussion. We have 39 societies, and the Geoscience and Remote Sensing Society is one of the 39 societies, and it has a global outreach of people. We are a relatively small society within IEEE. It's more or less 4,000 people. And it's global. We have 94 countries which are covered, which I guess is in itself a very good coverage. And the vision of GRSS is to be the leading society in science, engineering, application and education for the remote sensing and geospatial information community, which means everybody which is in this room, for instance. And the GRSS is basically distributed all over the world. We have 60 chapters, which means that you have 60 groups which are geographically working together in order to foster the activities of the society. And if you have noticed, the slide that Gerardo showed is basically showing the IEEE GRSS logo with Central and North Italy, because we have this conference is sponsored by the Central and North Italy chapter, which means that there is also a South Italy chapter, which means that we have two chapters in Italy. And yet, if you look at the 35 Italian people who are in the technical program committee, only three of them are Geoscience and Remote Sensing Society members. Okay? And if you look at the publication, you get that more people have been publishing in the Geoscience and Remote Sensing Society Journal, Transaction of Geoscience, Geoscience and Remote Sensing Letter, and the IEEE JSTARS. Okay, so what can I take out from this? I think that the perception is the IEEE is a good publisher, because more people work in the IEEE as a publisher. GRSS is perceived as not very useful by the Italian remote sensing community at large. This is just my feeling, and I would like to be, you know, confronted, and someone says, no, you are completely wrong, okay? But this is my thing. And I would say that this is a false perception. It's a false perception because IEEE Geoscience and Remote Sensing Society is bringing a lot of activities. It's true, we have journals. And by the way, we have one more journal which is starting this year. It's called JMAS. It's about small satellites. Okay, it's a completely new area that everybody's looking at. If you look at the most successful companies selling right now data, like Planet, for instance, they are using small satellite. Every NASA new sensor, you know, coming from Rome, there is a running workshop in Asia about small satellites, okay? So that's basically what everybody is doing, and we are there. We have the many conferences. We have a distinguished speaker program. We have people which are going around the world providing information. We have an e-newsletter where you find every information which is coming out, and a magazine which is full of tutorials, speaking of which one of the last was about deep learning, which everybody is speaking about, especially in our area as for big data and deep learning. We have specialty and regional symposia. We have a conference about urban remote sensing, which is my topic. We have a conference about hyperspectral remote sensing. We have other conferences in different areas, which are topic. And we are having regional conferences, conference in South America, in India, everywhere. We have technical committees, young program and summer school, awards, industry, and space agency, and so on. So the real question is, why are you still not a member? Okay? So I would like to, everybody's invited to discuss with me. I will be here. And now back to my more technical presentation is about urban remote sensing. Everybody speak, okay, urban areas, why urban areas? Urban areas are only 2% of the surface. I mean, 2% of the, of even less. And they are growing, of course, if you think about this. But they account, according to the United Nations, these are numbers which are a little bit too small. 70% of the economy, 60% of the global energy consumption. A lot of problems, a lot of challenges come from here. And of course, sorry, remote sensing data interpretation can help. Because we have information about a relatively large area. You know, this is Java Island. It's not really small area. We would like to have something like this, which is a map that says where the people are. In a very, very quick thing for every year, for every moment, as much as possible. And for each area, for instance, for some, an area like this, we want to have for every year the information about where are the urban areas, so we can obtain immediately afterwards the increase, and then collect it for many different situations. You know that, for instance, ESA has been considering a lot about these new climate change variables. One of them is a map of the world, and inside there is a part which is related to the extraction of urban area, because those are very important. Okay, forests are very important. I'm not discussing with Gerard about that. But also urban areas are very important for climate change. Okay. Now, global urban remote sensing and data fusion is very important because it gives, it's the only way to get a global view, which is what we want at this point. I mean, we don't want anymore to have very nice papers about the extraction of urban area classification, which is related to a very small stamp in a European city like Pavia, okay? Which was exactly what we did in the 80s or 90s. Okay, now we don't do it anymore. Okay, now we want to obtain a map of the whole Brazil, for instance. And there it's the point why we want data fusion. Okay, if we want Brazil, Brazil is not small, you know? It's a large area. You don't get it by considering one single satellite in one passes. You have to consider multiple passes, taking into account the fact that the passes are in different days with different conditions and so on and so forth. The second reason is basically that you need to apply, if you look, this is again Brazil, if you take there, you have to consider to extract urban area in very different areas. South of Brazil, Curitiba, okay? North of Brazil, Natal, okay? Center and Brazil, Manaus. They are very different if you look at the images, and those are basic images that you can see on Google Earth, just to give you an example, but if you look at the very different sensor, it will be extremely different, okay? And Brasilia, just to put the capital city there as well. There is a third reason that we need data fusion is because the fact that we have, it's a sparse area, only 2% I mentioned. Okay, this is the central part of Turkey, around Malatya, which you might not know, but it's the biggest place where you have the largest part of the production of apricots, okay, dry apricots. Come from there almost for every single thing where you are using them, okay? And this is the map of the urban areas inside. You see those small points correspond to urban area. Everything else is something, and we want to do it. Last reason why we need data fusion is because if you look at the specific date and you consider the coverage of that date, and of course you take out the images which are more than 50% or more than 60% cloudy, you get something which is like this, which might be even like this for another year. Okay? So you can't stand using one single sensor. You have to use multiple sensors. Okay, so data availability is the fourth reason. Okay? So we want to apply data fusion, and we start, this is the first part, it's about multispectral data and fusion. Okay, multispectral data at the global level are available for a long, long time, will be available for a long, long time, because everybody is considering Sentinel as a new way to get new data. I mean, we're starting to have some doubts about the NASA in the future, but we will see. The spatial resolution is ideal for urban development mapping. The problem is that we cannot just use one single index to obtain that information, which is the typical approach. We need to obtain something which is able to cope with issues like collected radiances, change with seasons and weather condition. The spectral properties of different urban areas, as I mentioned, they might be completely different, could be different inside the urban area, and so on. So what we have been working on in my university, which is basically, I should say, a work done by a former student originally of my university while she was at JRC. So the original work was basically done at JRC, and we worked on it, is the use of NDSV. So this is a vector. The V is a vector, it's no more an index, which is something that provides information about the different indexes computed by considering different bands, okay? And you have, this is forest, this is a urban area, this is water, and these are agricultural fields, okay? And the fact that urban area is more or less stable is based on the fact that artificial material do not have spike like absorption band or very big reflection band, like we know for vegetation is the case. So when we compute those indexes, more or less the value is the same. Okay? So, and this is a fusion at the pixel level because I'm considering multiple information, putting them together into something which is useful. Okay? Now this is the whole procedure. It's made by many different type and elements of fusion, which is exactly why I'm talking about that. The first one is the fact that we are considering a fusion at the pixel level. The second one is the fact that we have multiple images covering the same area. And for each of these images, we can compute different classification map, because we know that there are multiple classifiers. So let's start by making multiple classification map and combining those classification map into a single map, which is of course something that gives a better result. We have multiple ideas how to do that. I'm not going into the details of the specific presentation or publication, but of course this is an open field which many people are working on, which is called the decision fusion, because we are fusing different decisions. And of course, this is an example. The blue map is the one that we, for Sao Paulo, is the blue map is the one after the fusion of the different classification. The purple map in the background is instead where you have also some mistakes and errors which are due to the single classification. Okay, I'm just quickly going on, hopefully. Okay, the second part is that I mentioned, we might have multiple images. Of course, urban area, let's take for the moment out of the scene China. If you don't consider China and you consider an image every 10 or 30 days, urban area don't change too much, okay? And therefore, you can use more images of the same area in order to obtain information about the same urban area. And this is the idea. You might have multiple images, you put them together into a single image, taking care of everything, and then you classify, or you can use multiple images, classify each of them, possibly by means of multiple classifiers, and put them together And the result, as you see, is much better in the second case than in the first case, for instance. Okay? Now, the fact is that if you have multiple images, you might have hundreds of multiple images. If you classify hundreds of multiple images by tens of classifiers, you end up making a lot of computational time. So what we do is basically something which is in the middle. So we actually, for instance, consider multiple images in the same season, which are going together into a single image. And then we have multiple images, meaning that we have multiple composite images for different seasons. And then we use this multi-temporal, let's say, a sequence of data in order to obtain a classification. And this is exactly what we do here in this example about Java Island, all the urban areas. And this is what we have, considering the whole bunch of images in 1 year compressed into one single image that is classified. And this is instead using our idea to have a, let's say, group of images for each different season. And you see, of course, that there are less mistakes here and there, what is called salt and pepper classification noise. Okay, this has been proved a lot by many different analyses. I'm not showing only, I'm showing places all over the world to prove, that's my idea, to prove that we have something which is working everywhere. It's not the idea that we have something which is able right now to provide the map all over the world, but as soon as you want something, we are able to do that. Yeah, this is Jiangsu province in China, and this is our extraction compared with the extraction by Chinese colleagues done manually by using the same data set. And of course, were not able to analyze very small urban areas, while the methodology here is able to do it much better. And of course, if you want, if the last part of the fusion is the fact that we are able to obtain data and classification in multiple instances of time, and therefore have a multi-temporal analysis. Again, showing another place of the world, Istanbul, this is the different analysis using multi-temporal data from Landsat satellite from 95, 2000, and 2005 and 2015. Now, does it work everywhere? No. The fact is that it doesn't work everywhere because most of the cities that are in the area close to the equator are pretty much covered by a cloud almost everywhere. So in the idea of using a fusion approach which works everywhere, we have to use different sensors. And instead of using multi-spectral sensor, we use SAR. Okay? And again, Sentinel is okay. We have also SAR on the other side. So I'm showing here results which are based on the past, but of course we have also the new version which works on the present situation right now, Sentinel-1 here and Sentinel-2, the previous one. Now, for SAR, what we use? We use the fact that in urban areas, as we know, urban areas are characterized by the so-called double bounce effect. The fact that when you provide a SAR impulse, this is more or less coming back because of this kind of situation. The same is true also for mountains, okay? So there is, of course, some sort of problems, but it's very different from a flat surface like the sea. It is very different from cropland and forest like this area here around. This is an image of Gothenburg in Sweden, and very clearly you see where is the urban area, where is the water, and a lot of vegetation outside. Now, we can use this combining the data coming from sensor. The sensor here is ASAR, so the sensor on the Envisat satellite, and combining all of the images. And you see very clearly, for instance, for Italy, that these are the Alps. They are not urban areas, of course. But you see also very clearly all the different cities and the biggest cities in France, for instance, as well, and everywhere else. So we use a different methodology which takes into account this approach, which is called UX, urban extraction, very simple name, and is based on the idea that we have very strong scatterers Around them we have other scatterers, so we just pick the highest value in the scattering. We look around in order to obtain something which is still very high, and then we use some sort of post-processing in order to reconstruct the urban area. Now, this works, yes. It's perfect, no. Where it doesn't work, for instance, where you have a very large mountain range. This is Taiwan. And you know very well that Taiwan is basically from the north to the south, there is a very high range. Most of the urban areas are here. There are only a few small urban settlements around on the other side. But if you apply the system, I mean the methodology that I show, okay, you get the whole island, which is not urbanized, of course. If you take into account the slope, meaning the fact that there are areas which are very highly reflective in SAR, but those large reflection is not due to the fact that you have urban areas, but because of the roughness of the terrain, you get something like this, which is more in line, of course, with what we want to extract. Now, we apply that, as I mentioned, not only to Azar, but also to Sentinel-1. This is an example of a result for Tunisia, much quieter in the sense that there is not very big mountain range there. This is Sentinel-1 multi-temporal images. This is, the Sentinel-1 is the image, sorry. And this is the extraction compared with the extraction using Azar, so the previous. And of course, you see by the superposition with the optical image, just for the interpretation of the image, that the new extraction, thanks to the higher, finer resolution of the sensor mostly, is much better. But of course, we use multi-temporal data. It's not for one single image. It's something that is related to the use of multiple images. And again, the problem that I mentioned before. We had also quantitative evaluation for the whole China, considering the extraction for all of the cities in whole China, distributed by province, again, compared with manual extraction by the Chinese colleague. And it worked reasonably well. I mean, you see that the accuracy are not 100% for some of the provinces. They are relatively low, but in general, they are around 70 or 80% accuracy. Now, okay, we got SAR, we got the multi-temporal. How we can just put everything together? So what happens if we have SAR on the one side and the multi-spectral data as well? Let's say we have ALOS, Pulsar, Sentinel-1, Landsat-8, and VSAT-SAR on the same area, okay? Of course, they are also different time in this case, but it's just to give you an example. We have two problems. The first problem is related to the fact that we have different resolution. So we need to combine to move from one resolution to the other. And when you have multiple data, multiple resolution, you can end up having a map at different resolutions. So you need to know how well any specific sensor is working at different spatial resolution. And this is one point. And this we do by reaggregating spatially the different sensors. So for instance, we move from the sensor which have different spatial resolution to sensor here, the maps at the same spatial resolution, while the original images are black and white, meaning no urban area, urban area. Those looks like they are off focus. In reality, they are basically in gray level, because changing the resolution, you do not have anymore only urban area, only non-urban area. You have something which is in between. And this is especially on the edges. That's why it looks like it is off focus. Okay, then this is one part. The other part is about the fact that we have, The other part is about the fact that we need to understand what is the contribution for every single sensor to the classification according to the time when the image has been acquired. Because it really depends. As we know, in urban areas, for instance, it's much better that we have a lot of vegetation, because vegetation is very different from urban area, and therefore you are able to extract very quickly buildings and vegetation. While if you are in a very dry area, let's say Cairo in Egypt, is much more complicated because the object, which is the urban area, is made by material which are very close to the material of the surrounding area. So it really depends on the time, okay? And therefore we use this kind of contribution about NDVI, average NDVI, to obtain the information about the type of contribution according to the amount of vegetation which is there. Okay, so by combining the two, we had a final result, and I'm just showing very quickly one single result, because I guess I'm already a little bit longer than my time. In Guangzhou, this is the final classification, and this is the result of the PhD of my the PhD thesis of my student Andrea Salentinig, which shows that each of the single image you get a different overall accuracy. As we expect, Landsat is better than SAR, and SAR is working worse when the resolution is 75 meter spatial resolution than when it is 12 meter resolution. But when you combine all of them, the result is better. So you can get something which is better than each of the single element by using fusion. And this is the, you know, the final statement that I would like everybody to bring home from here. It's more complicated if you use multiple sources, multiple methodologies, multiple contribution, and you put them together, but the result is better. So about urban remote sensing, I would say that DataView, and this of course can be done for other group, so for other topic, but this is of course my contribution. Data fusion is crucial because of a number of issues. It solves the scale issue, because by combining different data, different spatial resolution, it is possible to obtain a result at the specific scale that we want. It solves the problems of the diversity, because the spectral and the spatial features can be represented by methodology which are based on pixel fusion, which are somehow more stable and robust all around the globe. It solves the sparsity issue, because where we don't have data from one specific sensor, we might have multiple data coming from other sensors. And it solves, and of course, it doesn't solve the computational factor, because if you have to approach more and more, analyze more and more data, that will require more power. But as we know, the power here is moving from the fact that we are no more, in many cases, using our laptop, but we are using cloud computing or parallel computing, and this is a problem that we might be able to solve by means of the technology. In general, I would encourage everyone to look at this area and topic if you are interested, because I think that working at the regional and the national level and tracking what happens to urban areas is very important. It is something where remote sensing might, and is actually playing a role, which is also the reason why many different big players in the remote sensing arena, and I mentioned here just very quickly JRC on the one side, DLR on the other side, are working on their specific map of urban area on the overall globe, okay? That is a sign that this is very important, and is something where we have many new possibilities for research, and I hope you enjoyed this talk. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Paolo, for the talk. I think that we can move some questions at the end of the session, so we can move on.